Welcome to Worship with Austin United Methodist Church. Our worship staff includes Reverend Dr. Donna Dempewolf, Reverend Amanda Larson, musician Susan Hayes, as well as special guests each week. Whether you're on a break from work or cozied up with a cup of coffee, you are welcome here.
I am Pastor Donna Dempewolf, and I'm glad to welcome you to worship at First United Methodist Church in Austin, Minnesota. Whether you are a seeker or a skeptic, a doubter or a wanderer, you are welcomed here and called beloved. Whether you're with us each week, or whether this is your very first time, our hope is that you will experience the heartbeat of God and respond with your lives. If you are in the Austin area, I invite you to join us next week in person. To learn more about our service time and ministries, please visit our website at austinfirst.org. We'll begin our worship service today with a prayer, and this is a prayer that we wrote collaboratively over 2 years ago. It's a prayer that highlights our shared desire to love courageously and to follow God's vision for our church and our lives. Thank you for worshiping today.
Holy Spirit, break through our hearts and call us to love courageously. By your grace, boldly show us your vision for First Church. Open our eyes to see it, our minds to embrace it, and our hearts, hands, and feet to fulfill it. Amen.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, you're so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to earth, you created, all for the sick became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see.
Would you join me in a spirit of prayer? Take a deep breath as a way to invite the Spirit to be present with us. For today's prayer, I'm reading one that was written by Dr. Tom Pace, who's the senior pastor at St. Luke's United Methodist Church in Houston, Texas. Tom writes, O God, there are days when I think I'm a pretty good person. I think, well, compared to lots of people, I'm doing okay. I'm conventionally nice, so perhaps I don't need any really significant forgiveness. But then, when I put aside my pretense, I know better. Please forgive me, O God, because there are things I have done, things I have said, things I haven't done. When I take a good, honest look at my heart and life, I really am ashamed. When people say critical things about me, it hurts. When people say nice things, it stings, because I know in my heart I can do better. The words of the old prayer of humble access, a part of the liturgy of the Lord's Supper, rings in my heart. I'm not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under this table, merciful Lord, but thou art the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. And yet, at the same time, You whisper in my ear and tell me about how much you love me. You remind me that my worth was established at my creation, that you have clothed me in the righteousness of Christ, and that I am to live out my identity in you. You tell me that you've restored me to the goodness in which I was created, that I too am part of the beloved community. So God, as you have forgiven me, let me humbly receive your forgiveness and make amends for where I have caused pain and done damage to your children and your world. And let me move forward as one who shares in your resurrection and transformation and forgiveness, knowing that nothing I have done or ever will do can separate me from your love. This I pray in the name of Christ. May Tom's prayer speak to you as his prayer spoke to me, as together we join our voices and say the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 16, verses 1 through 13. Jesus also said to the disciples, "A certain rich man heard that his household manager was wasting his estate. He called the manager in and said to him, 'What is this I hear about you? Give me a report of your administration, because you can no longer serve as my manager.' The household manager said to himself, 'What will I do now that my master is firing me as his manager? I'm not strong enough to dig and too proud to beg. I know what I'll do, so that when I am removed from my management position, people will welcome me into their houses.' One by one, the manager sent for each person who owed his master money. He said to the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He said, 900 gallons of olive oil. The manager said to him, 'Take your contract, sit down quickly and write 450 gallons. Then the manager said to another, 'How much do you owe?' He said, 1,000 bushels of wheat. He said, 'Take your contract and write down 800. The master commended the dishonest manager because he acted cleverly. People who belong to this world are more clever in dealing with their peers than are people who belong to the light. I tell you, use worldly wealth to make friends for yourselves, so that when it's gone, you will be welcomed into eternal houses. Whoever is faithful with little is also faithful with much, and the one who is dishonest with little is also dishonest with much. If you haven't been faithful with worldly wealth, who will trust you with true riches? If you haven't been faithful with someone else's property, who will give you your own? No household servant can serve two masters. Either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be loyal to the one and have contempt for the other. You cannot serve God and wealth."
Embezzlement, fraud, money laundering. Maybe we think of the movie All the Queen's Horses. It's a documentary about a woman named Rita Grundwell. She was the controller and treasurer of Dixon, Illinois, a town of roughly 16,000 people, a town smaller than the town of Austin, Minnesota. She was a long-term trusted employee who, according to one of the city commissioners, looked after every tax dollar as if it were her own. Rita did it all for the city of Dixon. She opened the mail, prepared and signed checks, reconciled the bank accounts, and over 30 years, siphoned $53 million. What did she do with it? With $53 million? She built one of the nation's leading quarter horse empires. At one world show, she entered 19 horses and won 9 championships. She won trophy after trophy after trophy. All the while, in the town of Dixon, staff positions were cut, budgets slashed, and the public infrastructure neglected. The rich man in our text heard that his manager was wasting his estate. It rubs against us. Wastefulness is a sin. We worry about wasting time, money, the environment, resources, opportunities. We wonder, did the manager pad his expense voucher? Did he put family members on payroll? Did he fail to collect the amount that was due? Was he an ancient day Robin Hood who stole from the rich to give to the poor? The text is silent. It doesn't say. The rich man just calls him in and asks, "What is this I hear about you?" I don't know about you, but the phrase, "What is this I hear about you?" is a red flag to me. Why didn't the rich man tell him what he heard? Was there an implicit knowing between the two? Was the manager, at least at some level, expecting the conversation? Or was someone setting him up? Was the manager surprised? We hear a sense of panic in the manager's voice. What will I do? I'm not strong enough to dig and too proud to beg. I still need to eat. I still need to be part of the community. As I pondered the text, I wondered, what kind of emotions did the manager feel? Anger or frustration for being wrongly accused? Or perhaps shame or guilt for having been dishonest? Brené Brown writes about emotions in her book, Atlas of the Heart. In her chapter, Places We Go When We Fall Short, she explores the emotions of shame and guilt. Shame is the fear that something we've done or failed to do makes us unworthy of connection, where we think to ourselves, I'm unlovable, I don't belong. Through interviews, some have shared with Brené's research team their thoughts on shame. They've said, shame is hearing my parents fight between the walls and wondering if I'm responsible. Shame is hiding the fact that I'm in recovery. Shame is not making partner. Shame is telling my fiancé that my dad lives in France when in fact he's in prison. Shame is mismanaging money. Shame is getting laid off and having to tell my family. Shame is hoarding possessions or watching my bank account grow, hidden for my eyes only. Nearly everyone feels shame at some point in their lives. Shame, Brené says, thrives on 3 things: secrecy, silence, and judgment. If you put shame into a petri dish and douse it with these 3 things, it will grow exponentially into every corner and crevice of our lives. There is an element of secrecy and silence in the text. We don't know what was heard. And there is an element of judgment too. You could no longer work for me. The antidote to shame is being gentle with yourself, being kind to yourself and others too, to say, this happened. I may have played a role, but I'm not defined by that role. Did the manager feel shame? Or did the manager feel guilt? Guilt is an emotion where we know we've done something wrong, something that doesn't align with our values. And then we try to do something right, like apologizing or changing a behavior. What will the manager do? There's no evidence of waste. Yet he doesn't dispute the charges. Instead, he concocts a scheme to protect himself when he is tossed out. He reduces the debt of some of his clients in the hopes that they will return the favor of mercy when he is very shortly in need. One by one, the manager sends for each person who owed the rich man money. He said to one, change it from 900 to 450. To another, make it 800, not 1,000. As the manager tosses aside the debt, it appears that he is digging the hole he is in deeper and deeper, wasting even more of the rich man's money. Will it work? Debt relief, as we know, is a touchy topic. It's especially touchy now with the passing of the student loan relief bill. I anticipate that we're not of one mind on this and of many issues, and that not being of one mind is okay, that we can love alike even if we don't think alike. Some vocations, for example, don't require a college degree, but they do require a truck with lots of tools, or a tractor, or other investments to get started. What about them? Now, I graduated from college in the 80s, and I paid off my debt within a year. But it was the 80s, and tuition costs were a fraction of what they are today, and Pell Grants covered over 50%. It was a different era. A colleague of mine, who is about the same age, and who went to seminary later in life, said with tears in her eyes, my debt will be paid off before my kids graduate from college. Now, as the manager tosses aside the debt, what happens? Here is where this puzzling parable takes an unexpected turn. The rich man doesn't condemn the manager, but commends him for his shrewd actions of forgiving the debt. He restores the man. He forgives him, all because he was clever. What's going on here? It's as if Luke is trying to provide an explanation, but he himself seems confused. It's as if he is saying, be honest, yet dishonest. Be clever, yet trustworthy. When in the story did the manager become dishonest? When did he waste resources? Now, we don't know. It may have been before he was told that he was going to be let go, or it may have been after, when he generously forgave debts, reducing the value 20 or 50-fold. Maybe the rich man doesn't fire the manager for not producing enough, but for holding on too tightly, for hoarding, for possessing, for making money the center of his life. Maybe the manager isn't feeling shame or guilt about having mismanaged money, but for all the times he let money drive him. To increase his commission, maybe, or to stay late at the office, or to take delight in seeing the pile of the rich man's possessions grow and grow and grow. All to have it fall apart when an anonymous gaslighting statement occurs, I have heard. It's as if Jesus is turning the idea of wasting possessions inside out and upside down. In Jesus' economy, resources, land, and money are wasted when they are hoarded. Holding on to what you own, collecting full value at any cost, not sharing with others. We are hardwired in our brains, in our bodies, in our very beings that we should take what we can get and that we make sure that we receive 100% value. In our world, a debt of 100 jugs of olive oil would not be reduced to 50. Rather, we would make sure that when the debt is finally paid, it would be 150 in return. A debt of 100 containers of wheat would not be reduced to 80. Rather, 120 would be paid in return. In the parables that precede this one, the parable of the lost sheep, the lost coin, the wayward son, there is joy when the one who was lost is found. I wonder, is this dishonest manager lost too? Lost in business dealings, lost in building a bigger bank account, lost in greed, lost in an economic system that works for the haves, but not the have-nots. And maybe he too is found. found when he is praised for giving away God's precious resources, of giving away forgiveness, of giving away grace, of giving away mercy. And maybe, just maybe, he comes to realize that some of that forgiveness is for him too, that he is not defined in God's eyes by shame or guilt, that he is not defined by his relationship with money, that he is not defined by the things he has done or by the things he has left undone. Maybe Jesus is not waiting until his books are cleaned up or until he becomes a certified better person to love him, to delight in him, to rejoice in him. Now, we thought this parable was about waste, but maybe it's about God's upside-down economy and God's extravagant forgiveness of debts. This week, I invite you to consider, what is my relationship with money? What emotions does it elicit? Do you experience shame? Because you are holding on too tightly, hoarding, possessing, making money the center of your life. Or because of the ways you mismanage money? Do you feel guilt for not giving freely? Or because you're giving to yourself and not to others? Or do you rejoice in how God has given to you and how you give to God, to others, and to yourself in return? Wherever you're at, whatever you feel, know this. You are not defined in God's eyes by shame or guilt. Your worst thing is not the last thing. God already delights in you. God already rejoices in you, my clever friends. Amen.
It is worth.
friends, wherever you're at, whatever you are feeling about yourself, know this. You are not defined in God's eyes by shame or guilt. Your worst thing is not the last thing. God already delights in you. Go forth, my clever friends, with extravagant forgiveness, surrounded by the grace of God, the love of Jesus, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessings to you.